Welcome everyone to the AA. Thank you all for coming. I'm Frederick Helberg and this is Lara Lesmus and we are unit masters of Inter 1 here. And tonight we have the great honor of introducing David Nixon, one of the pioneers of architecture for outer space. David has significantly influenced the development of space architecture in which he has been involved since the 80s. He studied architecture at the Polytechnic of Central London, now Westminster University, from which he graduated in 1971. After working for Foster's and other offices in the UK and in the US, he in 1978 formed the firm Future System together with Jan Kaplicki. And in the 80s, he was among a handful of architects invited to work on the design of the International Space Station. He later established an office in Los Angeles to focus on work across the space field. He has taught architecture at SIARC and at UCLA in Los Angeles. And as a result of 7 years of research, he in 2016 released this incredible 400-page book that was released here together with a lecture he gave exactly 1 year ago.
It was then 30 years ago in this same room that David Nixon opened his lecture, Design for Life in Space, by saying, "I had no idea so many people were interested in space." And Alvin Boyarsky noted then in 1987 that his work was full of an optimism and faith in the future that reminded nostalgically of that brief window in time here in London when, in the later half of the 60s, a similar move was discernible. Our ideas of the future have since changed, and since then it seems Hollywood is more concerned with preparing for life out of here than Bedford Square is. We have seen Matt Damon colonize Mars, Christopher Nolan has taken us through a wormhole in search for a new home, and Elon Musk tells us that the only way forward is for our civilization is multiplanetary. It is in this time that some of us find it productive to remain unrelentingly positive and energetic about what's to come, and find inspiration in careers like that of David Nixon, whose work embraces the opportunities provided by technology and contributes to the ever-growing human curiosity and ambition in its seek for new experiences. So we wonder really how many of us are interested in space.
And so once again, thank you for coming. Before we start, just have an announcement for an event that will take place here on Saturday called Little Architects. And Little Architects has been teaching architecture workshops in primary schools since 2013 to embed architecture into the national curriculum and develop an awareness of the contemporary built environment and society. The workshops are typically run within schools, but on Saturday, for the first time, they will be run together with David Nixon's about architecture on other planets at the AA for children between 5 and 12 years old with their parents. So please visit the membership site on the website for more information. It will take place here in front members room upstairs. And after David's lecture, there will be drinks served in the South Jury Room, opportunity to talk directly to David. And after the lecture, we'll also take questions. And also, I think that the book here that I hold in my hand is for sale at a reduced price in the South Jury Room. So without further ado, please help us in welcoming David Nixon.
Well, thank you very much for that introduction. It's a great honor and pleasure to be back here at the AA again, giving my third lecture on space. As just been pointed out, the first one was 1986, 87, when I just got involved in the field and was full of, as quoted, sort of energy and optimism. I'm not quite so much energy and optimism now, 30 years later. But it was a great pleasure to be here a year ago exactly talking about the space station. Now, tonight, I'm not going to be talking about that at all, and nor am I going to be talking about the work that I did for NASA, because I talked about that last year. What I'm showing you tonight is a patchwork quilt, a mixed bag of projects which I've worked on in the past 30 years, mostly for American clients in the US, but some more recently in Europe. And the purpose of the lecture, really, is to give you an idea of the that the breadth and the depth of designing for space as a specialized design field. I'm not going to be showing you fancy pictures of bases on the moon or Mars, which the sort of things you see in the newspaper, sort of science fiction sets, because I haven't been involved in any of those. The stuff I've done has been much more sort of prosaic. The folks, the architects who get involved in designing these wonderful concepts on the moon and Mars, either work for the big space agencies like NASA or the contractors, or else they come new to the field and they're full of optimism and energy, and it takes about two or three years for them to realize that, in fact, designing anything beyond Earth is extremely difficult. Space is very, very hard, and if that's one thing I've learned in the past 30 years, is that the rewards and the visions must be tempered with the reality and the difficulty of working in this field. So I've got 9 projects I'm going to show to you tonight, which I'm going to get through quite quickly, so we're not here all night. I'm going to start with a couple of examples of equipment designs. And the first one is a design for a wearable workstation, which dates from 1987. Now, some of you who've looked at shot video of the space station and other activities in space may have noticed that the posture of the human body changes in weightlessness. And I've talked about this actually at the lecture 30 years ago. The reason is that the human anatomy, relieved of the trouble of having to transfer weight and loads down to the ground from the head weighs 5 kilograms. And whenever I think about that, I always think about 5 liters of wine for some reason. But anyhow, it's amazing to think that the human head weighs 5 kilograms. So that load goes down through our spine, across the pelvis, down both legs like a giant tuning fork. And what happens when that weight is taken off is the human body takes on a much more simian form. You can see this here on the right. The series of drawings, this here done by an architect called Bran Griffin for Boeing. Bran, in addition to being an architect, was a pilot and a diver and also a very gifted life artist. And he was the first person to produce a guidebook, if you will, on the deformation or the alteration of the human body to weightlessness way back in the late 1970s, which was a revelation to me, because about a year after I started working in the space field on the NASA contract, a huge truckload of reports arrived from NASA containing all the information up to that point in time on the space station, which was hugely useful later on when I wrote the book, amongst which was Brandt's manual, and it really caught my eye. And the first thing I did, in fact, after getting into this particular field, was to go through a self-education exercise inspired by Brandt's drawings, where I did a series of exercises that explored the ergonomic and anthropometric changes and how those related to the kind of workstation environments and other activities that we were going to design into the module at that time. And coincidentally, a few months later, I had an offer of a flight on one of these parabolic flights, the KC-135, which I know Richard, the Frontier, knows well because he has had students fly on this. And for anyone who's not familiar with this, this is the best you can get on Earth or close to it in terms of weightlessness, simulated weightlessness on an aircraft. And the aircraft has a series of parabolas in the sky, very steep climbs and descents. And right at the top of the curve here, you get 30 to 40 seconds of weightlessness in which you can do experiments inside the aircraft. And conversely, at the bottom, you get 2 Gs, where you have to lie on the floor of the aircraft until it it starts its ascent again. And I had an offer on one of these flights from a company called Spacehab that was developing a pressurized module for the shuttle. I'd invested a little bit of money in the company at that time, rather foolishly, because later on I lost it all. But they kindly offered me, at very short notice, 4 weeks' notice, experiment space on this flight. And I had a group of students at the time, and so we very quickly came up with the first thing we could think of, which was a wearable workstation, this very odd, curious-looking contraption consisting of bits of metal bought from the local hardware store and the backpack. The very first laptop computer you can see here, this really crude device that was produced by a company called Radio Shack in the US. That was the very first time, years ahead of these Apple MacBooks, MacBook Airs that you see here. The idea was that in a space environment where you're going from one laboratory module to the other, you have a lot of information that you need to draw out of the various experiment racks. You have data, values, all kinds of information. And if instead of going to a workstation in the module, you take your workstation with you as an extension of your flight suit, you simply unfold it and deploy it at the point in your internal inspection or whatever it happens to be that that you would need to access something. So that was the original idea behind that concept. And if you can imagine this, this was a first generation, very crude prototype put together in 4 weeks for about $200, I think. But if you can visualize what that would be like today with the technology we have at our disposal in these MacBook Airs and other forms of portable equipment, I think it would be possible to design this workstation as a very, very carefully tailored, beautiful form-fitting device, very lightweight, that would still serve this purpose. So this was tested on the aircraft here and by one of the students, Joe Kennedy, who I believe was the first architecture student in 1987 to experience weightlessness on one of these flights. And it looks like Joe is seated here, but he's actually floating. He's got his feet attached to this framework here, which we had to supply to stop him floating away. And the purpose of the flight was really to test the comfort of this particular concept. These projects are not in chronological order. I'm going to be jumping about quite a bit because I wanted some video at the front of the lecture and some video at the back. So fast forward to 2007 and some school space flight kits. Now, just a little bit of history to this. I set up a space company in 2001 called Astro Courier in the United States with the object of developing very small pallets and carriers to fly experiments to orbit and back. Nothing to do with architecture at all. I thought I saw a market opportunity to do that, and these things, about the size of large laptop computers, would sit on this structure, which flies, at the time, as flying on the space shuttle. And we were well into development by early 2003 with the hardware. And then there was the second shuttle disaster when the shuttle Columbia disintegrated on return. And about a year later, NASA told us that they could not fly us under any circumstances on the shuttle with our payloads because they were removing all non-essential payloads from the shuttle flights as they prepared to close down the program. It was some years before they closed down the program. So at a stroke, 3 years' work and quite a lot of money went out of the window. And so we kind of scratched our heads and wondered what we could do with it. And the first thing I did was to move the company to Ireland, rather disgusted with NASA and its attitude. We went to Ireland, which has an excellent business climate for high-tech startups, and set up there. And About that time, there was quite a lot in the press about the concern that the government had in this country, in the US, that not enough young people were taking science courses at school and going to university. There is a sense, in high schools, that engineering is a boring subject. You're not going to get on in life if you become an engineer. Why bother to study A-level for it? And my daughter was studying A-level physics at the time, and one day I happened to pick up her textbook, and I looked at the topics inside it, and here was one on mechanics, which had several very simple equations. Anybody who's done physics at school will be aware of the fundamental equations of mechanical motion, distance, time, velocity, and acceleration, which set me thinking. And we used that as the basis of developing a flight experiment. In other words, shifting from the carrier and the payloads right into the experiment itself. That was fully funded by the European Space Agency at their incubator unit in Noordwijk in the Netherlands. And the idea was that we would develop an experiment that schools could launch into space to learn about mechanical motion using two types of accelerometer, triple accelerometer, which is an accelerometer. A simple accelerometer is what you have in an iPhone that enables you to change it from landscape to portrait format. You also have one in your car in the airbags. And inside here, we put two types of triple axis accelerometer, one that cover the macro Gs, the very high acceleration forces during launch and descent, and another that cover the micro Gs in orbit when you're experiencing very subtle motions. The idea with the experiment was that you record the accelerations every few seconds during the ascent. You know your starting point, you know your acceleration and your velocity, you measure against time, so you've got three of the four parameters, and from that you calculate the distance. And the idea was that schools, once they got the experiment back, would put a huge sheet of paper on the wall of the classroom like this, and they would calculate the distances covered in a two-dimensional graph form, and then they draw the whole trajectory of the spacecraft launch and ascent, actually on the wall of the classroom. And then once it was up in space, they would do a similar routine for some of the very subtle motions of space. So this was manifested on the third photon mission, which was a joint European-Russian mission, and went up almost exactly 10 years ago. It was integrated 2 weeks before the launch, right in the middle of the photon capsule, which you see here, and here it is in orbit. And we'll just have a little bit of I'm not going to go through all this because we've all seen these. Is we didn't get the data back because the battery'd run out. And, you know, in space you have to test, you have to test, you have to test, you have to test again. And we did the test on the battery, but it was a special double A battery that you saw in the photograph, two little cells. It had been sitting for 2 weeks at low temperatures inside the capsule at Kazakhstan, and there was no power, so we got nothing back. So immediately we got the thing back. We put it on the European simulated flight and ran it on that and got the data. So we were able to salvage victory from the jaws of defeat. And that was successful. Now, I don't have a video of that particular flight, but for those of you who are interested, I wanted to show you this little bit of video on the left, because this explains the movement and the freedom of movement involved in these simulated microgravity flights. So here they are at the bottom of the curve while they're lying down in the 2G. I just wanted to add as a postscript to that organizations like the AA can come up with ideas for experiments to test on these flights, and there's a process you go through to apply for funding, the development of the experiments, and if it's approved, you can fly it on that particular flight. So if anybody has got a bright idea, there is a procedure and a protocol that you can follow to get it up in the air. I'm going to turn to spin-off. Spin-off is a term used in the space business to describe a technology which is developed for space that finds applications on Earth. And it can take the range from a direct technology application to pure inspiration. And I've got a couple of examples I wanted to show you on that. The first one is a hydroponic birdhouse concept from 1995. This shot on the left here is in the early 1990s, the late 1980s, NASA was very involved in hydroponic development of research and development of plants, with the ostensible end target, end aim of being able to include greenhouses on Lunar and Mars bases to grow food, as Matt Damon was doing with his potatoes in the film. At that time, it was very much under development. And 20 years later, we have products like this now, which is called ZeoPro, which is an artificial type of gravel with plant nutrient embedded in it, slow-release plant nutrient. So you put your plants in that, and you put water in it, and that will release the nutrients slowly to whatever plants you have, whatever purpose you have. And I was invited in the mid-1990s by the Kazumi Corporation in Japan to be part of their birdhouse program that they had at the time, where they were asking architects and designers to produce concepts for bird houses. And I came up with this rather whimsical idea for a hydroponic, zeoponic birdhouse with a little capsule for the bird inside, with the nutrient impregnated gravel at the bottom on which the bird would build its nest inside. And this would be irrigated by water collected by these wings, assuming that rain would fall on a regular basis. Water passes through the to the hydroponic medium down below, and then the plants grow through holes on the outside. If you have a drought period, you get a hose pipe and spray water on. You bring it down every year, the end of the season, to clean it out, and up it goes again. So that was a kind of rather whimsical concept for an application of a technology developed by NASA. Moving to inspiration, I was given two rail stations to design in the early 2000s for a new line, rail line going in at San Diego in Southern California, which has been busy building a transit system. And we did two stations. The stations ran through a neighborhood where the client, the community, absolutely insisted that the station architecture looked like a Swiss chalet. Right? For some reason, it was up in the hills, north of San Diego, and maybe they had a Swiss community there. I don't know. We produced one design that we had to chuck out because it certainly didn't look like a Swiss chalet. And I mean, I think a lot of architects are faced with situations like this, where a client comes along and says, "I'll give you the hotel project, but the entrance lobby must look like the Hall of Mirrors at Versailles," or something like that. And you have to cope with it, you know. You have to live with it, and you have to cope with it. And so I scratched my head figuring out how we could tweak the sort of deeply pitched roof with long overhangs that you typically have in Swiss chalet design without having it look sort of rather kitsch-like. And at the time, I was following the progress of what was going to be a crew escape vehicle for the station through what they call this lifting body returnable capsule design. And I was intrigued by the relationship between the main fuselage of this vehicle and these little sort of turned up wings, and the transition, the kind of geometrical transition from sort of one to the other. And it occurred to me that maybe we could borrow some of these lines, you know, some of these curves, and put them into this particular structure. So I ended up with an all steel roof that looked like this, which was, I think, the best that we could do under the circumstances, with a fairly shallow curved ridge, fairing into sort of turned up edges along each side, and then cutting it off at each end in very much the same way that the tile structure on the vehicles changed from white to the thermally resisting black tile underneath. And so this was a typical setup, an isometric setup. And then the station ended up looking like this. It was an all-steel construction with semi-monocoque, all-welded construction, sitting on very chunky piles. This was a high-risk earthquake zone, and so anything in the way of structures like this had to be supported off fairly beefy columns and foundations too. So this essentially was an attempt to employ inspiration, a certain amount of inspiration from that particular vehicle, and tweak the design in such a way that we would be comfortable with it as designers, and the local community felt that it looked like a Swiss chalet. Well, I never found out whether they did think of it as a Swiss chalet, but they did like it. That was the main thing. So now I'm going to move on to talking about modules, which was really where I came into this project in 1986, doing the work for NASA. So from San Diego to Belgium, and this was a contract for the European Space Agency that I worked on about 8 years ago. Belgium used to have a nuclear research program aimed at becoming energy independent and providing all the country's electricity from nuclear energy, until they had a change of government about 12 years ago where they threw out the nuclear energy option and went back to more conventional energy. And what they had done is to do a certain amount of research on the disposal of nuclear waste in a certain type of clay subsoil that was very, very stable in the middle of Belgium. And they had they had built a long tunnel with two lift shafts going down, and they were about to start testing whether this would form a good place to store nuclear waste on a long-term basis when the program was canceled. And so they were left with this particular subterranean tunnel arrangement. And the nuclear agency concerned had an idea that they might be able to use this for isolation testing, for creating an isolation capsule or chamber where people would go down and live together for 6 weeks in highly confined, highly stressed environments, and they would be studied. Their behavior and performance would be studied from a laboratory on the ground, because there is an urgent need for more research into the long-term psychological aspects of long-duration spaceflight. And so we have the contract to develop a little plug here, rather like a catheter going into an artery to open it up, or a stent used in cardiological surgery. Plug that would come down the tunnel in pieces and then insert all by hand, because these were quite lightweight lifts, into an end tunnel. The project we did with RFR in Paris and Astrium in Bremen. So this was the plan. And this was what the tunnel system looked like. Pretty sort of basic. The main tunnel was a combination of prefabricated concrete panels, panel liners, and some old steel construction. And the idea was to go in here and bring the new modules down piece by piece and insert it through this tunnel. And so we developed a kit of parts for that looked like this, each one small enough to be lifted by, and light enough to be lifted by four people off the back of a truck into the lift, down the lift shaft, and then along the corridor to the final site. And then we would come along afterwards, the contractor would come along afterwards and fit it out on the inside. So the plan was to actually provide three two-person sleeping compartments and other fairly essential facilities: bathrooms, exercise facility, study training area, and a wardroom. All highly confined. We tried to do something interesting with lighting, from day to night lighting, to change the feeling of the space. And so we were about ready to go ahead with this, and we had to say in the report that the worst place to put this tunnel was right at the end, in a kind of cul-de-sac in the drawing I've just described, because if there was a fire at that particular entrance, the occupants would not be able to get out. And in confined environments, if you have a fire in a tunnel, it's the smoke that kills before the fire, so, as it does in an aircraft fire in a fuselage. And unfortunately, that killed the project because we produced a report saying you can't possibly put this particular isolation chamber into a cul-de-sac, tunnel cul-de-sac, because of that risk. Plus, we were piping in gaseous oxygen because one of the things that we were trying to do was to create a completely artificial environment. And so that very sadly killed the project. We rather hung ourselves on that one, but we really had to do it because we couldn't, in all honesty, recommend the option that they wanted. This is something I've been doing recently based on the realization that we need to get a lot smarter in terms of capsule designs for the future. The space station was delivered to orbit primarily using the space shuttle, which had a cavernous payload bay that was 18 meters long by 4.6 meters diameter. So it was possible to take all these huge tin can modules and prefabricate them and send them up inside the space shuttle. Well, the space shuttle no longer exists. It was terminated in 2011. And we're back to conventional rockets now with payload compartments on the top. And here's an example of probably the most successful one around at the moment, which is Elon Musk's Falcon 9, which has the ability to fly back. The lower stage can fly itself back to the ground and land vertically after all the fuel's been spent. So that's a major leap forward in rocket technology. But as you can see, the payload compartment is a lot less than the space shuttle. So we need to get a lot smarter about how we stack modules and payloads inside this. And I was kind of using this as just tinkering with various ideas without any particular application in mind, and asking myself, is it possible to design a spherical capsule that collapses in on itself, sort of deconstructs into a ring so that you can have three capsules squashed together inside the payload compartment, and then once it's in space, you deploy it into the full volume. And I was kind of inspired by, again, back to inspiration, a historical naval telescope, very beautifully crafted brass telescope that had multiple telescopic elements that allowed the thing to expand to well over a meter, I think. And even onion rings, and how the morphology of onion rings works when they are stacked together as they grow in the onion, and when in fact you cut them like this into separate rings. And that led really to this investigation, where I tried to deconstruct the spherical capsule into a series of rings like this that stacked inside each other and then would deploy in orbit automatically using a system of springs and bolts to link themselves together. So essentially what you have is, and that's a section, that's a slice through the five rings. So when they go up into space, they essentially look like this. And this is this blue line here is the thermal insulation on the outside, because these have to be thermally insulated. And there has to be a debris shield on the outside of that. So here it is all stacked on a consecutive basis where one bracket, the outermost bracket, supports the next one in line, which in turn supports the next one, supports the next one. There's a sliding joint here which allows these sections that support the rings to deploy outwards in a prescribed sequence, with the motive power in this case being springs, or it could be a ratchet type mechanism, a rack and pinion type mechanism. And then once they'd reached full extension, using a similar, these red things are electrically driven bolt actuators that they use on the space station when they connect modules together, borrowing the technology from the space station to drive home a secure structural joint between these rings, and in the process compress seals, which you can just see here, a triple seal arrangement, one active seal and two redundant seals, so that you have a structurally homogeneous and an airtight and a thermally insulated approach to the design of these. And so it's at the bottom here, you can see how these deploy sort of one after the other. And then these little red things are the electric actuator bolts. So that really is sort of something I've been doing recently, just tinkering with an idea for no particular application at this point in time. So how are we doing on time? Right, so I'm ending up with three examples of infrastructure. Infrastructure being the ground aspects of the space business, tracking stations and launch facilities, which is where everything starts that goes into space. And I was lucky enough to get involved in several projects, several space infrastructure projects in the US over the years. I picked three examples of that tonight. And the first one was a master plan for the deep space tracking stations that I was involved with in about 1992. Deep Space Network is the principal world network for receiving communications that come from missions to other parts of the solar system, such as the Cassini mission to Saturn and its rings, the earlier Galileo mission to Jupiter, the Rosetta mission that European launched to the satellite, so on and so forth. All the information from those missions comes in through radio signals to the deep space network, and you can see some of the big antennas on the left there. The thing about this is that for some reason I've lost a slide. Never mind. The information coming in from these missions is a point radio signal from a very, very long way away, but the Earth rotates very inconveniently 24 hours a day. And so when they set up the deep space network, they had to pick three sites around the world, roughly 120 degrees apart, to ensure 24-hour reception coverage from these signals coming in from deep space. And the three sites were set up at Madrid in Spain, Canberra in Australia, and Goldstone in California. And on the left there, this is the site west of Madrid, not far from the Escorial Palace. This is in Canberra, Australia. And these photographs were taken in the 1980s. And I was involved in developing the master plan for the extension of these sites, the deep space network, basically proposing new antenna sites according to a fairly strict set of requirements based on the geographical position of these, all sited inside bowl-shaped depressions in order to shield the positions of the antennas from radio interference in the atmosphere as much as possible. Spacing of these at different distances, at 200 meter, fairly strict 200 meter distances, which would enable them to optimize their ability to pick up these radio signals, which are incredibly weak, coming in from the outer end, the outer extremities of the solar system, compared to the amount of energy that a butterfly expends flapping its wings. And so you need a huge ability to pick up the very, very faint signals involved. Moving forward to 1994, I got involved with a company called Kistler Aerospace, which was one of the first private companies to develop privately developed vehicles. And this is a very primitive piece of video on the left, which I'm going to show you and talk through. It's a two-stage vehicle, basically, with both stages that that came back to Earth. This is the lower stage, which is returning after separation on a parachute. And down it comes onto the ground and lands on airbags. So looking here at a sort of video animation from the sort of early 1990s level of capability without any sound and everything. So the upper stage goes up to orbit. Out comes the payload, ejected. Back it goes, back down to Earth. And Kistler was one of the two companies selected by NASA at the time to go forward with the development of this vehicle, the other being SpaceX. And if you followed the space news in the space world recently, SpaceX has taken the lead. In fact, this company was never able to arrange the multi-million dollar financing it needed to move the project forward. So it died a long, slow, painful death. But when I was involved in it, the plan was to build a commercial spaceport at White Sands Missile Range in the middle of New Mexico, which was a US government test site for rockets and missiles, a huge piece of land that occupies most of the state of New Mexico and is several hundred miles from north to south, and I think about 200 miles across, absolutely huge. And it's got clearance all the way up to space. So technically, you can land launch a rocket that goes to orbit and back from that particular site. And one of the things about designing for space is there are three basic rules that you have to follow: safety, safety, and safety. Right? Because you're dealing with something that is highly explosive. A lot of rockets burn liquid oxygen and hydrogen, and if you combine those together accidentally, you have an explosion. If it's liquid oxygen and kerosene, which it was in this case, then you have a giant fireball. It's absolutely crucial that when you lay these things out, you take safety into account from the outset, and that means that you need a lot of room to separate things like the vehicle hangars, the visitor facilities from the launch pads here, the launch pads from each other, and then the storage of the propellants on the site need to be separated from each other and from the other facilities. And I was reading, this is a topical project at the moment because Britain is at this point thinking about building a spaceport somewhere in the United Kingdom. And I was reading the RFP on that the other day, a request for proposal, and I don't think the word safety and separation distances was in it anywhere, so I don't think they've got a clue what they're doing. But anyway, that's another story. So this is the concept that I came up with, which was a very simple rail-fed system of feeding the flight-ready rockets from the assembly and maintenance hangars two launch sites on an electrically powered mobile trolley like this, with a system of delivery for the fuel lines and the data and various other things up this very simple tower structure here and into the vehicle, and then separating the liquid oxygen and kerosene tanks the right distances. There is information you can get from the US Department of Defense that covers all these kind of things, which you can follow, provided you know what the chemical composition is and how much fuel there is. You can determine what these separation distances have to be. So that was fun. Very sadly, that didn't go ahead either. That's a kind of sort of artist's impression of what it would look like on the site. You get an idea of the kind of scale of the development. And finally, 1999, I got involved with yet another company doing a similar kind of thing at Mojave Airport in California. This was called Rotary Rocket Company, and it was a single stage to orbit vehicle. That means everything occurred within one aeroshell, went up and did its thing in orbit and came down again. But this one had a unique return landing capability, where the plan was for it to use helicopter blades to slow its descent and make a pinpoint landing at the airport from which it was launched. And the site was at Mojave Airport, a very well-known research flight test airport in California, where Bert Rutan ran his scaled composites company for many years. He built the Voyage Around the World aircraft. He built Richard Branson's Spaceship One. He's built a lot of stuff. Principally known as the biggest aircraft graveyard in the world. This is where airline companies send their jets they no longer need because the airport offers very cheap parking terms. And the jets fly in here and they're parked, and then they slowly rot in the desert for the heat of the desert for 10 years until they start falling apart, and then they're broken up for scrap. And when Freddie Laker's Airways company folded up in, when was it, the 80s, all his aircraft ended up here. So I had a call one day from the client. I was already working for this particular client on another project. And he phoned me up one day and said, David, I need two buildings quick. And I said, how quick? 5 weeks start on site. He had the contractor lined up, the steelwork fabricator, even the company building the tall doors. He had the site given him by the airport. The airport was doing all the infrastructure, the utilities, but he didn't have two designs. So we produced, he wanted these two buildings. And there was no time to do anything architecturally extravagant. And we ended up with two very simple, rather boring metal boxes here. The lower one that he needed first was designed in 2 weeks with the site plan. And I gave the drawings to the contractor, and he took them in the next morning to Bakersfield Building Permit Department in the middle of California, where he had an inside track. And he had them stamped back that afternoon before the close of business. Can you imagine that, getting your building permit approved in one working day? And he started on site the next morning. So that one, the little building, was done in 2 weeks. It's a very simple metal clad box. And then the bigger building in another 3 weeks. And we had some problems with these doors because of 100 mile an hour wind gusts that you get in this particular part of California, caused by a sort of microclimate effect, and how they would impact these doors, these very tall doors that were sitting on tracks at the top and the bottom. But we managed to do it, and the whole aim of the exercise, the very quick exercise, was to get the rocket, to roll the rocket out, right? I use the term roll out in the aircraft and the space business to describe the point in time where the thing comes out of the hangar, the aircraft or the rocket or whatever it is, to great applause, politicians and their wives attending, champagne is opened, snacks are consumed, and everybody has a good time, and the children get given balloons, and everybody's happy. So this was a shot of the night before the big rollout that was attended by about 1,000 people, including all the local senators and congressmen and women and various sort of dignitaries from California. And 3 weeks later, they started the flight test. It was really, really quick. The they'd had $33 million given to them by Tom Clancy, the author of Cold War adventure novels like Hunt for Red October, which is one of my favorite films. And Tom Clancy was a space buff. And so he agreed to bankroll the company up to the completion of this stage of the project, which was the first flight test. And so the first flight test took place a few weeks after the building, and I got a piece of video of that on the left. It's a very strange object. It was very strange indeed. There were two people inside that, two helicopter pilots. So everything went well with the flight test, three sets of tests. And then the usual thing happened. The money that was supposed to come in for the second stage financing, which was an order of magnitude higher than the $33 million from Tom Clancy, didn't materialize. And a month later, the company folded up and was bankrupt. It was a very sad end. But at least they got as far as this in a very short space of time. So now I'm going to show you a piece of video, just to finish up with, a brilliant piece of video by a firm in San Francisco called Fatbox that gives you an idea of what the mission would have been like if it had gone ahead. So there you are, some of the weird things I've been doing in the past 30 years. Thank you.
That's fantastic. Thank you so much, David, for that introduction to projects that perhaps many of us have not seen before. Also people that came to the lecture last year. We will open up the floor for question that will be then followed up afterwards when we
We'll have some drinks for everyone. We can have a more informal conversation. But to kick it off, I think perhaps many people would have similar questions, but I'm very keen to hear a little bit more from you about the creative process or the creative challenge, perhaps, because you mentioned Tom Clancy, and we know other people that have perhaps, as I would say, or I would guess, been involved in the space design industry for very passionate reasons, and perhaps not because they only like to resolve small technical details and they don't care what the technology is used for, but it's specifically the exploration and the discovery that drives them. And I would expect that maybe part of your work is driven by passion, of course. So I was kind of curious to hear a little bit about this 30-year-long incredible career where, of course, not in your work only, but in all work that explores space in this way, of challenges and projects that get canceled, and because it's the most challenging field of design there is in the whole world. So just as a creative person, it would be interesting to hear from you ways to deal with this sort of way of working where you have to be prepared for projects getting shut down.
Yeah. Well, I got involved in the field purely by accident in 1984. I was writing an article on the space station for the Architectural Review when Peter Davey was editor. And in the course of that, I was on the faculty at SIARC at the time. I was interviewing NASA field centers and going to visit field centers. This was right at the beginning of the space station project. And I was as I was walking out of the door of one of those interviews one day, the guy said, well, would you like a contract to do some design work? And I thought, yeah, fine. He said, we've got money. We can give you a contract to do some full-scale design work on the space station habitation module. And that was right at the beginning of the project when the budget was fairly big and they had quite a bit of money to spend on research and development. So one thing led to another, and that contract lasted 3 years. And by that time, I was sort of hooked on space. I was absolutely, completely hooked on it, and I couldn't leave it alone. And much as I tried to go back to what I would call mainstream architecture, it kept drawing. And it was that point where I started to fan out into some of these other projects, like the infrastructure, you know, the deep space network tracking stations. You know, I'd never worked on anything like that before while I was here in this country, and it was a revelation. It was a series of revelations. It didn't always go right. And as you've seen, you know, space is really hard to do. You've got to be dedicated to do it. And even as an architect, you've got to be prepared to spend 5-10 years designing something and then have the whole project just crash and burn. And I know architects at NASA and the Jet Propulsion Laboratory who have spent their whole careers working on ideas for the lunar bases and Mars bases, and none of it's gone ahead, you know. And they get deeply frustrated, but they still carry on. That's partly why I avoided lunar bases and Mars bases, because that really is a point of no return. I mean, at my particular age, I knew it wouldn't happen in my lifetime, because a project like that takes 30 years to complete. And so I kept well away from that and did this more basic stuff. But even today, you know, after all this time, I regularly look at the space press and follow the progress of what's going on. And I continue to be fascinated by this field. And I think it's one that architects really need to get into more. We have with us tonight in the audience David Wong, who is the chairman-elect of the first professional space organization in the world, which is the Space Architecture Technical Committee of the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics, and with about 50 members in it. So now space architecture has come of age. And I urge you to talk to him afterwards if you're interested in this. Space architecture has come of age. As I was saying to Richard last night, just giving a little talk in his office, when I got involved in 1984, I was going to meetings at NASA, and they were saying to me, who are you? I haven't seen you before. I said, well, I'm an architect, and I'm working on this contract. And so they said, well, what are you working on? Are you choosing the colors of the walls? And now architects are involved in projects right from the outset. There was, until recently, an architect in charge of all the manifesting of the supplies on the space station, all the replacement spare parts, all the crew food, all the consumables. There have been two architects who have tried for the astronaut corps in the US. They didn't get very far. So there is a tremendous... I was talking about Brand Griffin right at the beginning of the talk. As Brand is a pilot and a diver, he's a test diver and a brilliant artist as well. He's a true sort of Renaissance character. And so there aren't many people like that. Maybe 50 architects and designers, industrial designers around the world in this field, spread around the different countries. So it's a field full of opportunity. And I would urge the AAA to think about this as a future sort of, you know, niche field of education. And I mentioned earlier the opportunity to develop experiments for test flight, and that's a possibility too. So I continue, you know. I mean, at this point, I'm tinkering with ideas because there aren't any applications really to use them on at this point. It's a bit of a trough in the human spaceflight field, but I'm you know, hope springs eternal, and I'm an eternal optimist. So.
I'd like to ask if, since you know the field, and do you think that now architects that are involved in the field are more focused on, I mean, the issues of inhabitation, are they more focused on the traveling itself, or designing for inhabitation of like capsules or modules that would be deployed in other planets?
It's really an amalgamation of architecture and industrial design, where because you're designing, and Richard knows all about this, because Richard has flown experiments on these aircraft too with his students from Munich, right? You, as an architect, you're trained to think at a fairly coarse level. You think about designing human activities into your buildings, right? You plan a building. It has this, that, or the other, lecture halls if it's a school, or, you know, so on and so forth. But the thing about space is that the relationship between the human being and the surroundings becomes much more intense, where, as I was giving in the first example, you design a workstation in a situation where the body posture changes, you need to be sure that it works right. So for me, that was the first revelation, which is that I needed to go back to square one and figure out how to design all over again, because none of this, I'd had no experience of anything like this in my previous career. And so that was one of the exciting things about it. And then I had to go and do some night classes in things like structures and, you know, a lot of stuff like that to basically gen myself up on some of the terminology and things involved. And I was going to extension classes at UCLA for several years to try and get more familiar with this. But I want to stress this point. There is, I think, only one architecture school in Europe at this moment that is running courses in this, which is Vienna. David may know more about that. In California, you've got the University of Houston that for many years ran a Master of Architecture degree course. I ran one at SIARC for 4 or 5 years and then had to stop because the money ran out. There is a lot of opportunity here to begin to explore this field for a new generation of architects. And I need to perhaps say one other thing, that I belong to a generation as Don and Chris and Richard do in the 1960s that was enthralled by space, because that was the time of the lunar missions. the time of films like 2001, you know, and it was all absolutely fascinating stuff back in the 1960s. And I have noticed in lectures I give around the world, and particularly in the last 5 years, that there isn't as much enthusiasm with young people in space. I think it's become more commonplace. We see more pictures of space on the television or in the newspapers. So it's become a little more commonplace as just another high technology field. And somehow we have to bring it back to that level of excitement. We have to inject that level of excitement again into it, particularly with the politicians of the world, because unless we can convince the politicians that, you know, the future destiny of the human race is off this planet, which it is ultimately, eventually, and that to get there we have to get into the space field, unless we can get that penny to drop in their brains, right? Why not start now and plan for it? Why wait till it's too late? All these arguments are important. And we're living in a time when there are so many negatives, so many other types of pressures on, you know, the environment and so on, that space tends to get pushed onto the back burner. And it's very unfortunate. It's happening in the US, it's happening in Europe, and in other places. For me, you know, at this point in my life, 70 years old, it's really too late now. I can't contribute much. I tinker away ideas and things. But for you guys, this is a brand new field. So I would urge you to keep a weather eye on it and keep an open mind. And if an opportunity comes up to get involved in it, you know, go for it. Go for it. Yes.
Could you give us an update on where we are with Virgin Galactic and the shot, the two-person shot around the moon, and the Mars mission? Is there any? What are the prospects that young people could think about? Could you just give us?
Well,
a quick
Virgin Galactic update? Is Richard Branson's company, and they were going to fly missions to the upper atmosphere, not into space, but upper atmosphere for $250,000 a seat. Everybody would, about eight people a flight, would get about 3 minutes of weightlessness. That project ran into trouble because during engine development, two people lost their lives, and then there was the pilot who lost his life about 2 years ago doing a flight test. So, unfortunately, that company has run into all kinds of problems. The other project Richard mentioned is SpaceX and Elon Musk that announced recently that they are going to try for a mission to the moon that passes around the moon, not lands in it, with two, God knows how much they're paying these people, but a hell of a lot of money. Two people in a capsule that will go and circumnavigate the moon and come back again. That is at a very early stage, and I've been getting comments on that among the space community, which are very negative because of all the safety issues involved.
What about NASA, for example? Is there anything planned, or is it all shut down?
Everybody's waiting to hear what the new White House regime, right? I'm going to call them an administration. The new regime in the White House is going to do, and he hasn't said anything. And Europe, unfortunately, continues to play follow the leader being the U.S. So they're waiting on Trump to decide what he's going to do.
What's happening in China?
Is going ahead with a space station in about 5 years, and India is making great progress too. So India and China, there's a lot happening, but not so much in the West, except in terms of automated missions without.
And the space station will. Become
space station
is going to finish soon.
Yeah, 2024. It's funded until 2024. And, you know, anybody's guess is what's going to happen after that. The Russians are talking about building their own station. But there needs to be a second generation space station because it's doing some terribly important research that will not be completed by 2024. such as some of the medical research, which I haven't talked about here tonight, but there's a lot of very important medical research going on the space station about the ability of the human physiology to, and the psychological and physiological ability of astronauts to exist in space for more than a year, and the negative side effects of that on all sorts of things, sorts of aspects of physiology. So that work needs to be done, and there needs to be a second generation space station, whether it's a private one or a government one remains to be seen. But that's the sort of project that needs fresh ideas, as I was talking about trying to demonstrate with my little module idea. There's a lot of opportunity there for new ideas, and those ideas can come from outside the space field, from, you know, people like you who've got an idea, who think it might work, and us lot working inside the field because we have such blinkered, we're so preconditioned by some of the constraints that it's difficult for us to open up and think in that kind of way, because you know, we're constantly thinking about the problems that it could be raised. So I urge you here at the AA to, you know, to consider getting involved in this field at some point. I think it would be a good place to do it, an independent school like this. So,
just want to like continue on what you mentioned about should try to inspire the current generation of our generations of students and people to get more interested in space. I mean, from your experience, can you see like what is so different between the 60s and like to now, to like you know, this centuries? I mean, obviously at the time there was like the moon landing and the general kind of the environment make it, you know, become the biggest agenda at the time. But I mean, with nowadays we don't have that. But I mean what kind of, I mean, can you have any suggestion of like any ambition, what might help to kind of inspire the generation?
Well, I'm always been very glad that I was an architecture student in the 60s, because that was such an exciting time, not only in architecture, because architecture in this country was breaking out of the straitjacket of the sort of 1950s, early 60s brutalism into a looser type of more tech building, you know, high tech and all the rest of it. It was also, I mentioned before, the two defining moments, the Apollo missions to the moon and the 2001 film. But there were other things going on, like the first artificial heart, Christian Barnard in South Africa. There was the Concorde supersonic aircraft, which has gone now. All sorts of things, early computers. And I, for one, was fascinated by all this in the 1960s. I couldn't really figure out where it would all fit together in my future, but certainly that was an inspirational time. This was before computers, of course. We were all sort of still drawing with ink on Mylar, and unfortunately that's almost gone now. That's very sad, but that's another story. Maybe not at the AA, but it's gone in a lot of other schools, I can tell you. I think that, you know, I think architecture's become sort of such a mechanical automated process today, where we sit in front of screens and beaver away and click, 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 and that's it. And the creative process has lost a certain tactile pleasure. And I think that's another reason why architecture schools are so important, that they can still make that part of the course. But once you leave here and going to an office, be it an office like Foster's or a small office, or say, you're on a computer and that's it, basically. There's not much else. And I think it's wonderful that computers have done all that, but I think at the same time, it's a little bit sad that the richer experience of creativity has been lost a bit. And I don't know what Don does in Kent, but do you know what I mean? Yeah, and that's sad, but I think maybe it's just a generational thing, or maybe it is a serious concern. I don't know.
I did some teaching in Greenland, and it seems to me that that kind of near space the near space of polar regions is much more achievable and still requires a lot of science and excellent detailing and good concepts of community and space, planning for good community design in small, compact objects. Because people want to run, they want to explore, that desire amongst young people.
Right.
You can see that still exists. And that, to help that, I found teaching in Greenland was very exciting because that is raw, you know, it's really raw nature up there.
Yes.
And it's extreme, you know, you have no sunlight for 6 months of the year and bright sunlight for the other 6 months.
Yeah.
And so it's a kind of extreme environment. And that, I think, a school should have an extreme environment which you can include space, you can include polar regions.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we're going to have to move out into polar regions to give people that sense of raw nature, which we're losing so much in with our increased urbanization. I found that really fascinating and uplifting to work in those environments. And not too expensive. You can do a mountain lab or you can do a polar lab very cheaply, actually. But I mean, I'm talking, you know, 100,000 or something, but that sort of budget, you can do a tremendous innovations with solar energy and all these things. And I think that's a really important future focus, near future focus, which will help us in space. I don't know what you think, but...
Well, just maybe as a final comment on this from me, the other thing I learned, really, is just following on from Richard said, is that, sustainability in space is window dressing. And sustainability, as we understand it in the architecture field, is basically just window dressing. What we need to move into is survivability. Architecture of survivability and how architecture can survive whatever nature or mankind throws at it. So I think that is another sort of parameter, really. We need to raise our game in architecture from sustainable design to survivable design, I think. And it has to do with what Richard was talking about.
We are sort of running out of time, but we have one question from a student also before we join for a more informal conversation.
I want to ask a question which not necessarily should be considered as political one, but I mean, from being Russian, the notion of a space program, especially in that time, was extremely important. And talking to my grandparents or somebody, that was a huge thing. And one of the biggest drivers for the huge for this program was competition with the US, because there was a constant if they speak up until now how we're going to beat them or how they beat us, or you know, who beats whom. Mm-hmm. So can we say, for example, the Russian space program for Moon was canceled straight up after US landed there, Russians were we don't need it anymore. So can we say that this certain slowdown in this development of the space program, but maybe also slowed down in a lot of areas in general, is exactly due to lack of this competition? Not rivalry, but the notion of opposing
people. Well, the interesting thing about the political aspect is what began as a competition ended up as cooperation, because the space station was in very, very deep trouble in 1991 when it had reached the end of the line in terms of cost. It was over budget. They couldn't possibly get it down. It survived a vote in Congress by one vote of being canceled. And then Yuri Koptev of Roscosmos came along, and just after 1991-1992, when Yeltsin was in power, and offered to build two modules for the space station at a fraction of the cost of what NASA was going to have to fork out in terms of money, and that enabled NASA to drop the budget, and the thing went ahead. So what began as competition after Kennedy's lunar announcement and so on and so forth, in 1960, two or one, whenever it was, ended up as cooperation that is continues to this day, regardless of the political disagreements on this planet. Everybody works together in space because that's the only way they can survive, through cooperation. So that's one of the great things about space, that it is possible for countries who have been Cold War or Hot War adversaries in the past to come together and work for the common good. So it's a textbook example in international cooperation, I think.
Sorry, before we end, was there any more questions?
So I was around at about the same time as you at the AA. I ran a unit with Mark Fisher, if you remember. Right. Mark, and of course, a great deal of optimism, Archigram, an incredible buzz of activity and a belief in technology. So I'm going to try and answer your question a little bit. Why aren't we still doing that? Because a lot of my students have got a kind of conscience about all this. You remember, there was no energy problem. Oil was never going to run out. You could do what you wanted. Very, very different times. Students now, certainly a lot of my students, are interested in disaster relief. They're interested in large-scale hydroponics. They're interested in what's going on in cities and making them more habitable. They're interested in favelas. They're looking at poverty in India. So I think what has happened has been a more introspective approach by students now. I don't think they're any less optimistic. They might be a bit less optimistic. They're certainly very realistic about what we've got and what we've got to deal with here on planet Earth. And what I think is fantastic is that they approach that with all the energy, commitment, and technology spilling over from the space, from space design, and bringing it back home to do something a little different. So that's my comment.
I was just wondering, has your work taken the pleasure out of watching films like Star Wars? Do you feel like a surgeon watching a medical film?
Not really, no. Now, the last space science fiction film I watched was The Martian, you know, with Matt Damon, which was... the space community has discussed this film amongst itself. And, 50% say, yes, that's quite a good rendition of what would happen. Kind of fell apart at the end, and the other half said, this is ridiculous rubbish. So, no, I love it. I still love the science fiction aspect. I think that's a very important one, too. And there have been a lot of space films. And they did the same thing with Gravity, you know, the film with, I can't remember her name. Yeah, and they pulled that apart too and dissected it and said what was wrong. That's okay.
Oh, there's one more question.
Right.
Thanks for letting me jump in. Richard Wolf, I just have to say, what a fantastic talk. But is there anything wrong in celebrating space style? As an industrial designer, Raymond Loewy's work was of great influence during my time at Lester Poly and during the 80s. And the fact is that whether we like it or not, architecture and space is a bit like doing underground stations. You know, is it engineering with architecture, or is it engineering on top of architecture, or is it frankly just space style? And I'm kind of struggling with the notion of space style at the moment, because there has to be an overt, in all of the clips that you showed and all the projects which are going ahead, and unfortunately not reaching any form of conclusion, right? There is a notion of an aesthetic, isn't there? And I just wondered if you could just express whether or not you feel that you are, as it were, dressing engineering or if you are creating engineering?
I'm not sure there's a short answer to that one. I think that in all the projects that I worked on, you have to address the engineering as the number one issue, and that certainly from the outset. And as I intimated, it was a struggle to begin with to convince engineers that a designer had a role to play. You mentioned Raymond Loewy, and in fact, he was very much involved in a project called Skylab. He was the one that persuaded NASA to put the first window into a spacecraft so that astronauts could look out of it. And there's a story attached to that, which I talk about a bit in the book. It's a sort of apocryphal tale. I don't think that's a short answer. I mean, I think the inspirational aspect, I've mentioned a few projects where maybe, you know, for one reason or another, I drew on inspiration. There is definitely a style. There was a space style in the 50s. There was another one in the 60s, and there's one now. And I think that you tend to find that the closer you get to reality, the sort of more nuts and boltsy and sort of nitty-gritty it becomes. And the earlier concepts of sort of von Braun and some of the earlier science fiction films had a much more sort of streamlined look, you know. I'm thinking of something like The Forbidden Planet with, remember that film? Forbidden Planet is a good example where that sort of high-scale aesthetic, space aesthetic, was sort of fed in early on as a vision. But I don't think there's any hard and fast rule one way or the other. You do tend to find that architects and designers coming into this field for the first time that aren't familiar with all the ground rules and the criteria produce these wonderful, extravagant designs before they get on the learning curve. And then, as reality sort of sets in, it gets like that. David will tell you, because he runs these space conferences around the world, that that the committee gets a lot of papers from people, way out in the outfield with fantastic visions for bases on the moon or Mars, where it happens to be, and none of it couched in reality at all, purely based on style and stuff. And we have to tell them that, go back and read a few books on it before you do it, right?
So, yeah. Okay, I happen to know that there's at least one AA student in the audience who is currently working on a project in space, a lunar habitation project. Well, so on that note, now we please join for a more informal conversation and having a drink together. Thank you very much, Manija, for co-organizing, and thank you very much, David Nixon, for giving this wonderful lecture. Thank you.